right, let's go to the next one. It's a Ronald Ventura cage.
Yeah, wow. This is a, you really see the, Ventura, I always love, Ventura is very skilled. I mean, he is an excellently skilled artist, and he can really paint practically anything. But what sets him apart from many others is also the content of his work. And you will see in this work, there's also so much of meanings inside this cage. So I think the title of this work is Cages and Void. And it was exhibited in that exhibition, Cages and Void. So if you will see the cage itself, you will notice a lot of gray rectangular portions, and I think that represents the voids. Whatever they mean, I think Lisa or Tonico could expound on the subtext in this work. But this is, to me, an excellent work of Ronald Ventura.
Comment from Leon: this is absolutely stunning, unbelievably amazing.
Referring agree to completely.
This work of Ronald.
Do you think if you were to commission a work like this now, how long would it take to get one? What's the waiting list and how much would you have to pay?
Well, what I heard that something this size will set you back like
30 million.
That's what I heard for something this size. Wow. And
the size is 84 by 60.
Yeah, 84 by 60. Yeah. So this is a steal. At any price less than the going rate for this sizes of works now. Yeah.
It must be beautiful to behold in person, considering the size of this work.
Yes, the composition of this work is amazing. That sets RV apart, no? It's the skill is there, but how he composes the work is that's his real talent. No, that's his real talent.
Yes,
the theme, the composition. Anybody can paint, but not everybody can compose a good artwork.
Tonico, any juicy tidbits you have for us?
Well, this is a very, very important work from an important series. I believe it was in Perotan, no? Gallery, and whatever. It was very sought after, and it was really about cages and voids. In my opinion, among those works, this is the best one because some of those other works are monochrome. This has splashes of color. And I feel that the void is the area outside the cage. And if you look at the Rococo people inside, they are all trying to get out, no? And it's a mix of classical and modern at the same time. And I really think that this is a great opportunity to buy because it's only starting at a fraction of the current asking price of Ronald Ventura, no? It's like one third, starting at that, no?
Competition for this piece.
Yeah, and it's difficult to get something because this is the time that, his price level jumped up so much also. And I'd be very interested to see how this ends because, we should patronize our own and Ronald Ventura is definitely one of our best artists, no? And this one in particular, in my opinion, is the best of the series. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's move to the next one from a master, no less, Romulo Olazo.
Wow, beautiful. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Huge.
Well, to me, this is one of the most beautiful diaphanous works that I have ever seen. This work, interesting, is that we sold this in 2014. And at that time, this was the highest ever sold Olazo in 2014. And now, after possessing this work for 6 years, the owner decided that he has moved on and enjoyed the work for so many number of years. And he thought that it's about time to pass it on to a new owner. And I was very happy to see this again. In fact, the Leon Gallery van has this painting as its the picture covering the van. So that's how much we love this painting. Yeah. So this is also published in two books as well as having been exhibited in two different exhibitions of Olazo. Fantastic work, I must say.
Let me go back to what you said. So you're saying this was sold at an auction previously at the Leon Gallery?
Yes, in 2014. So if I'm correct, I think this sold for 3.5 something million in 2014. Today, 2020, we are starting this at 4 million. And I think at 4 million, it's a steal. Because I do not think we can find any work of this quality readily in the market today.
Yeah, well, it's a major piece, as I said.
Yeah.
And it's two times over a book piece. So it's a very important work. Apart from the scale, which makes it quite major, it's 60 by 48 inches.
Colors are so vibrant.
You know, the picture doesn't do justice to the painting. It's actually much nicer in person, no? And I feel partial to Olazo because in college I used to make a little money by selling his paintings as well. And I know the history of this piece. Yes.
You did not hang on to your Olazos?
I was just selling them. I didn't have money. And yes, I didn't hang on. And I know there's history involved with are selling then in this piece. It's not mine, but I know a person who went after it because of that also. Used to sell Olazos and never hung on to one. Mm. Which we regret now, no?
I regret it since I've been your friend since college. I regret
after
it. I'm
college,
resentful now. Resentful.
Well, a collection of painting loan. I guess.
You see, and then you see,
a little thing, you know, you acquire and you sell to acquire something maybe bigger, better. So, you know, you don't really, I don't know. Tonico, Steve, your collectors, you let go of pieces and acquire some. I mean, it's when is the best time? Maybe we'll discuss that later. We'll discuss.
We have to talk about people who get attached.
Okay, I'll tell you a secret. Actually, I was one of the doctors of the great Olazos on the twilight of his years. Because I'm a urologist and he had some form of urologic problem, which I treated medically, nothing surgical. So I was so fortunate that he was actually able to give me about three items.
Wow.
Three Olazo works of the Diaphanos, which I don't plan to let go in my lifetime.
Oh, you're so fortunate.
Luckier than me, doctor.
Yes. So I cannot relate with the attorney because ever since I collected 2011, actually I haven't even let go of just one work. I haven't unloaded any works of my collection.
Mm-hmm.
That's how swapping I am. And that's why my wife is angry at me.
Yeah. Well, all I can brag about is I met him.
Oh, he's charming, huh? He's very,
very
charming.
Very, very. And you know, they used to run a frame shop, right?
Yes. Yes.
Well, I didn't have money then, but I really wanted an Olazo. But anyway, those are the regrets in life. Let's go to from one master to another. Let's go to Amor Solo. This is a beautiful, magnificent work.
Wow, this is a beautiful Amor Solo. When I saw this, you know what's interesting about this piece? Well, probably among the dealers in Manila, I can say that we fortunately have had the most experience on Amor Solos because we get a lot of these things from the States. And the size of this painting is actually large for an Amor Solo. It's 36 by 30. So this is considered a major work of Amor Solo. What makes me like this painting a lot, is the face of the girl. She's very pretty, number one. And what makes it interesting is that it is a war scene. It is a scene done, it's a scene from 1945. And I believe that the lady in the painting, the subject in the painting, is lit by fire and not by sunlight, as Amor Solo has been known for. So I think that's what makes this painting very unique. It's beautiful, it's large, it's unusual, it's a war scene, and it comes from what you would call the golden period of Amor Solo. I personally feel that the golden period of Amor Solo is anywhere below 1950. Yeah, of course, the earlier the better, but the war scenes have a certain premium in it. Yeah, so a beautiful work that has always been in the Philippines, from always been in one family. Yeah, very fortunate to have this work.
Lisa?
Well, what I'd like to contribute is that when he painted this scene during the war, Amor Solo was actually a tenant of the family of Corazon Cuanco. And he was unable to pay his rent. And at one time, he offered to pay with paintings, which was refused. So he had to leave his little apartment downtown. So you can imagine what a treasure trove of whoever it is who was his landlord must have now. Maybe this is one of the paintings that the Corazon Cuancos said was not good enough for their rent.
Possibly.
Another juicy tidbit.
There's a scene of Rizal Avenue, war-torn. It's just the skeleton of the famous theaters. And that was the view from his window in 1945.
Oh. You know what they say, though, that he tended to romanticize war or Manila during the time of the war?
I think only to get to find his sanity. Because, Amor Solo is always seeking the beautiful. So you can imagine living for 4 years in this war, in this ravaged circumstances.
All right, let's go to the next one. We have two slides for this because it is a massive work. Tonico?
You know, this is a spectacular work. If you see the size, it's more 8 feet by almost 20 something feet, no? So in terms of perspective, it can't even fit in our exhibition room, and it would take, you could parade 5 people along this painting. And Rafi Napa is one of the more sought after contemporary artists, and again, the picture doesn't do justice because it's a combination of a thread on canvas, no? So it's almost like a three-dimensional work. And the problem with this, not only will you have to showcase the length, but you need the proper vista or the distance from the painting to actually enjoy it. And then you need to come in to see all the details as well. But this is a major piece that any contemporary collector would be happy to have.
Let's show the next slide just to give you an idea of the scale of this work. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
So that is
24 feet.
That is a what you call a lunatic's work, and I love it.
Why do you say lunatic?
Why do you say lunatic?
Rafi na is Rafi, ika nga sa Tagalog sira ulong trabaho, but that's how Rafi is personally. He really puts his heart into his works. That's so intricate to do, huh? So painstakingly done. And that's a huge work. So I can say that he was a lunatic when he did this.
I wonder how long it took for him to do this.
Exactly.
Wow.
Doctor, it's supposed to be the result of a medical condition, an allergy to oil and acrylic, like Koya.
Yeah,
Lisa mentions Hoya because Hoya, during his golden period, was using a filler that he eventually got
for the
allergic to.
Yeah,
for the impasto. In the same way, the Rafi Napa altered this technique because of allergies as well. No, But as Steve mentioned, it's very intricate work. Mm-hmm. And it's something that you need to see from a distance and you also need to see it from up mm-hmm. close to really mm-hmm. appreciate it.
So there could be something like Van Gogh here, you know, where you get allergic and then you go, you know, a little, as you said, sira ulo.
Yes. So we better not give Rafi absinthe. Huh?
Yeah.
Better keep an eye on him, Doc. You should get him on a patient.
Yes.
Allergies.
The next work is by, speaking of Lisa, Jose Joya. Beautiful work.
This was still the time when he had his allergies, right, Nico?
Wala pa. His allergies came up in the 70s, 1973, like that.
So this is
to the period. That is his golden period. I think that's the end of his golden period. I'm partial towards that year because I was born that year. And so was Marcos Lignani, 66. So, but this, what we found out later on is, not only is this an important work, but it's also a book piece. It's in the Joya book. Yeah. Although it's not stated in the catalog.
This work is fantastic. I always believe that the best works of Joya were from 1959 to 1966, because prior to 1959, I think he was still looking for his the style that he eventually took. So prior to that, he was in New York. So you will see works from 1958, from 1957 would be very Franz Kleinish or very Pollockish. Yeah, but in 1959, he started to have a direction. And then up to 1966, where this work culminates. So to me, the best work, you see all the impastos and the best of his abstract works are from this period. Because in 1967, he became a grantee of ACC, and his works considerably changed. He started doing his zodiac signs, those round paintings, and he started to have a different direction. So for very serious collectors, this work falls under the best period of Joya.
Shades of Blue.
Yes.
Shades of Blue.
The title, Angeles.
Sky and Rivers of Pampanga. Angeles.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we just showed you the starlots, not to say that there are no more. These are just the highlights. And on your screen, we will be showing how you can register online to bid. So check that out. And also where you can check the other artworks that will be auctioned off on September 19 at 2 p.m. Okay, so you may view the catalog at this link that we are showing to you now, as well as the link to register and bid. Okay, so earlier, Tonico was talking about art, investing in art, and you were alluding to the back of the Lee Aguinaldo diptychs.
Yes.
All right, perhaps we can show the tag at the back while you start telling us continue your story about the Lee Aguinaldo.
Sure. So if you look at the tag in the back, it says that the two paintings were sold as one for $3,000 in 1971. No? Mm-hmm. The value of a dollar to in 1971 is roughly translates to $6.40 today. So this is the tag. No, it's $3,000 paired with Linear 99. So it was for the two. So it doesn't make sense to break it up now when they were also both sold for the two. Now, $3,000 translated to the current, because of inflation, value of a dollar, comes up to $19,200 now. Because it's $6.40 per dollar, roughly, in terms of inflation. Now, the opening price of this Lee Aguinaldo is at 8.4 million pesos, which is $172,555.46.
Talagang.
So if you kept your cash in 1971, your $3,000, that would be $19,200 now. Whereas this painting is starting out at $172,555.46. So in essence, if you do the math, the value of this painting went up 100% every year since then, roughly. So now this probably is going to break the record, or it should break the record for Leo Aguinaldo, because as it said, it's the probably the most important piece of Lee.
So it was acquired. It was first
it's part of the Sao Paulo, Paulo Bienalen, and that price, no?
So in those
you can see it's the Loose Gallery in EDSA pa. This is the tag. There's only one tag for both. But if you can read the thing, it says paired with linear number 99.
But you know, can you comment? Even in the way before, Lee has always been known to price his works very high. In fact, he even priced his works more than a Amorsolo. Ang taas ng tingin niya sa sarili. That was how he was viewed, no? Even in Jerome's beautiful story about Lee that came out a few days ago in online in ANCX, you will see that Lee really held on to all his best, all his paintings, and not merely wanting to barter it for whatever provision. He was really loved his work so much that he priced them really high. So that was the reputation actually that stuck with Lee. In fact, even when he died, he still had some works that he wasn't able to sell until the end.
What could $3,000 buy you at that time, Tonico?
Yes, I was 5 years old, so I'm not sure. But they said you could buy the top of the line S-Class Mercedes-Benz for a fraction of that then.
Oh, really?
But just very high.
Just go with the figures that I came up with. No, $1 in 1971 is equivalent to the purchasing power of $6.40 in 2020. So the difference is 540 over 49 years. And if they kept it as $3,000, they would have $19,200 today. But this painting is starting at $172,000. So it shows to you that whoever bought it and held on to that time, has appreciated over the years spectacularly.
Or if you kept it in your family, no, handed down to your heirs.
If you kept it in your family, yeah.
Of course, the question is, are artworks good investments? It depends on the artist, right? So let's go to Amorsolo. Amorsolo's The Offering. Again, going back to the question, how much would this have fetched? I mean, Lisa, you talked about how a landlord said no to this, to the works.
Yeah, you can imagine at the time, rent would have been about 20 pesos. 10 pesos. So this artwork would have also been 5 to 10 pesos a month. So you can imagine the quantum leap.
Okay, if you're looking at it as an investment, though, and maybe you could go next to the Ventura, how do you know when you're buying a work that it will appreciate? Is that the consideration, you know, that you're investing?
I have a different perspective on my collection, because I collect not because of the investment side. That's why my wife's getting angry. So... for me, I collect even though I don't know the name of the artist, as long as it has like a connection to me or my younger years. Sometimes I don't even memorize the name of the artist, or until I buy the fourth or fifth work of this particular artist, then that's the time I begin to memorize his name. So that's how I collect. I've never looked at it as a form of investment, because I have never sold any of my works yet. I'm not saying I'm not going to sell, no? But
since the guy came on to his olazos.
Yeah. As far as I know, I don't want to divest them because I love them too much. Maybe my kids will like them, but it's fortunate that my kids are also art inclined. So let's see. But for me, I think some people buy it as an investment. I'm not gonna hold it against them. I mean, artworks are like blue chips. They always go up. It's very seldom that the stocks go down. So I guess I won't blame them if they're gonna invest in a good artwork. There are some blue chips around. There's some regular that you wanna, like what you call a startup company where you wanna invest, and then sometimes these startup companies just booms and your investment goes up right away. So I don't know. Attorney.
Well, obviously there has to be a bigger decision made when it's an established artist like Ronald Ventura. But Cez, bear in mind, when you're talking to Steve, myself, Jaime, Lisa, you're talking to people who are all infected by the collection sickness. So our primary motive is never thinking of a return on investment and whatever. But more often than not, we're asked questions about how much will be this worth in X amount of years and whatever. Now, art throughout the world, if you look at the index of all artworks that come out of auctions and whatever, because gallery dealings are not transparent, it looks like art goes up on a compounded rate in a tremendous rate, higher than all other alternative investments. The problem with that is it's only limited to a few names. Those few names are the ones that really go up. So it's a cliche, but we always say, buy what you like, because once you develop your eye and whatever, then chances are some of them will go up. But none of us in this webinar really are in it for the money. If ever, sometimes we sell, it's to acquire something new that caught our eye or whatever.
Jaime is smiling.
My nose was itchy. No. I mean, come on. No, to Nico. I mean, we have to be realistic a little bit. I think when people buy works, I mean, tell me if I'm wrong, please. I mean, it's always with the, you know, you always think also, will you be able to resell it if you get tired of it? I think that's also a consideration.
Correct.
I mean,
that is a consideration.
You'll ever buy a work and, you know, you can't like sell. I mean, you can't hang on to things. What if a rainy day comes and you can convert it into cash, no?
Correct.
But going to your point, I mean, it's like stocks, no, in a way. When you buy a contemporary artist, they're very young, they're cheap, but of course you take the risk that they may not go valuable, I mean, after a certain period. But if you buy blue chip, they're a little expensive already, but you're sure that their values will hold, or if ever they rise in value, maybe very, very gradual, no? Not abrupt.
Ronald Ventura blue chip na yan, syempre.
I think
super blue chip.